I never knew my grandfather O'Brien. And since the family does not speak of him, I will never know how important Appalachian stereotypes were in his life. Being labeled a hillbilly must have done something to him, but how he carried that weight, and how it affected his tormented life, and contributed to his eventual suicide, will remain a mystery. My father never struggled with the label. He took being a hillbilly to heart, and spent his life backing up, apologizing for being alive. I've spent my life trying to escape his hopelessness, and of course to run from something is to be affected by it. In my life, one irony seems to compound another. I was trying to escape my father's despair, but hold on to him, and his vision of subsistence life at the same time. As the distance between us grew, I became more like him, and finally returned to his home, trying to find the life he left behind. Looking back on all this brings the last page of The Great Gatsby to mind again, its boats against the current, and the illusion of forward motion as I slip back into the past.
When you first meet a West Virginian, one of the things they do is define where they are in a web of family. You know, I'm so-and-so's uncle, I'm so-and-so's daughter, I'm somebody's son, and then the other person will respond back, oh, well, did you know this person or that? And then before you know, as soon as they get that settled, then they can begin real conversation, you know. But they have to get that settled first. The implication there is that you are in a web of connections and that they do go back through time and they're all around you. My sense of middle-class America right now is that they seem to be adrift. The dominant culture has lost some sense of direction or a sense of purpose. They don't quite know who they are. But in West Virginia, there's a clear identity. People in West Virginia tend to have their feet on the ground, and they know who they are. They have a clearer sense of who they are, and that makes them, I think, less pretentious than a lot of other people. There is an attachment to this landscape because I've met too many people who, when I talk about it, immediately respond. You know, if you're born here and you identify, you don't even have to be born, but if you spend a lot of your life here and you identify with it, there is something about the landscape and something about the culture. There's a sense, it feels old. If you look at the malls and so on, I can remember driving down through Harrisonburg a number of times and thinking, I could be in Oregon right now. I could be in Texas, I could be in California, and it would look exactly the same. There is no sense of place. It's become generic, you know. And I suppose it is romantic that I'm attached to that sense of place, but I don't like that generic feel. I feel unanchored, you know, like I'm gonna drift away. You know, there was no sense of permanency, no sense of looking back culturally, into the past.
Edward, is the piece going to be in tomorrow's paper?
No, I didn't have it together. We had marijuana discovered locally.
Thank God, not part of that.
No, you're not.
Okay. All right. Soon. Okay. Don't forget the ad.
And good luck. I read that you were going to be over in Marlinton doing a reading.
Yeah.
Right over there. Good luck.
Yeah,
I can't
thanks,
make it,
thanks.
But I would like
All right.
to come.
All right. Okay. Take
okay.
care.
Thanks.
Yep. For the longest time, I thought moving here or there would change me. You know, I had this delusion that with all my troubles and complications, that if I moved to a simpler place, you know, I would solve those problems. And of course, that's silly because you carry the problems inside your head as well. Yeah, I need a piece of coconut cream pie to go.
Is that all for me?
That's it.
Poet says something to the effect that grassy plains or rolling seas, it's all the same to me. My home is in my head. And that struck me immediately when I read that it's true.
How's it going?
Thank you very much.
Okay.
That's pretty
good. All right. Dinner at 5 then? Okay. All right. Okay. I'm going to make some soup. All right.
Okay.
See you at 5. everyone's home is really in their head, you know. And then, but for me, I realized at my age, I was spending so much of my time in memory, and that remains true. I'm always thinking, I'm always lost somewhere in the past, going over something or having a small film strip of something that happened to me, usually as a boy, running through my mind, that's where I was, that my home really was locked in those memories in my head. It just seemed accurate for me. And I know that seems like a contradiction after talking about the attachment to the mountains and the people here. And I suppose it is a contradiction or a paradox, but, you know, both of those things are true at the same time. But I think, anyway, people are paradoxical. And I think very often with human beings, two contradictory things can be true at the same time with them. And it is true for me.
Contrasting an imagined Victorian world, of which they believe themselves to be a part, with an imagined hillbilly world, up convinced middle-class Americans that they had indeed reached the peak of Western civilization. Franklin's elite told and retold exaggerated stories about their neighbors for the very same reason. In fact, there was probably more urgency in the county, in that people saw themselves as barely escaping the dreaded hillbilly ranks.
There's just a lot more to escape here, and that effort of escaping also makes people push other people further down a lot harder. They invariably would begin with a disclaimer, oh, I've got nothing against those people, but they're some of my best friends live in the North Fork, you know, and so on. Like it, and it sounds so much like the typical white answer to, you know, oh, I'm not a racist, why, some of those boys are the best athletes we've got, you know. But it's interesting to listen to people in this county who, on this side, who will talk bitterly about the outside, labeling them as hillbillies, and they're tired of these hillbilly jokes and tired of America thinking of them as hillbillies. And then within minutes, 3 minutes later, be talking about the hillbillies in the North Fork, and why are those people mad all the time? You know, they've just called them hillbillies. They understand their own anger, but they're laying the same opinion on the people over there and are totally mystified by why those strange people are mad.
As poor as we were, my father's attempt to create subsistence life in southwest Philadelphia had nothing to do with poverty. Food caught or shot or found was better than anything store-bought. More to the point, God had put wild foods in the world for a man to find. Eating fish from the rivers, game from the fields, was taking communion.
There's something enormously pleasurable about finding mushrooms in the woods, coming home, cutting them up, cooking them, serving them to my wife and my friends, because the process, it's uninterrupted. The process goes all the way through to completion somehow. And while that doesn't make practical sense, there's a deep satisfaction involved in that process. The same with deer, you know, or fish, you know. It just plugs me into the world, I feel, in a very immediate sort of way. And that's romantic, and I know it, but it's what I feel and what I respond to. So there is that aspect of subsistence life, but I think it really is at least as much romance and self-delusion as it is anything else. But we all need delusions. I think we do. The pleasant ones. I thought that a book like this, the best thing it could do for the individual who wrote it or for someone who reads it, is to re-ask the questions, hopefully in intelligent ways, and then after you leave the process, there's been some light shed on those puzzles or those mysteries that you can't resolve. And so you do come out of it with, a deeper understanding.
The wisecrack I made to Dave Harbert, my phenomenologist fishing partner in Oswego, about my existentialism being Appalachian fatalism dressed up for town, may not have been a joke. But then again, no one fits his or her culture exactly. Like human beings generally, my father was a complicated web of inherited traits, personal experiences, fears, frustrations, memories, and thoughts. His personality was a light show, shifting and changing moment by moment. To suggest that his life or mine can be explained by a single fact of biography is to reduce both of us to stick figures in a child's drawing. Who knows about these things? Trying to explain yourself to yourself is a dubious enterprise.
This is a production of West Virginia Public Broadcasting.